This is a glass of water, colorless, tasteless. It contains 100 gamma of LSD-25, 1/10 of a milligram, the equivalent of 1/600 of a grain.
Say you can see it.
No, I can't quite see it. Tell me about it.
Hail Satan. Hail Satan.
I can't tell you about it. If you can't see it, then you'll just never know it. I feel sorry for you.
America in 1966 was changing. The use of psychedelic drugs had reached such a point that fears were echoed in the press and government. Thomas Dodd of Connecticut held Senate meetings in order to pass criminalization laws. At these hearings was Timothy Leary, who, when asked if LSD was dangerous, said, "Sir, the motor car is dangerous if used improperly." That spring, Anton LaVey forms the Church of Satan in San Francisco. And even Time magazine over Easter weekend graces its cover with a completely black background with red font asking, "Is God dead?" Monsters begin saturating the print market with Warren Publishing's titles Creepy and Eerie. Gothic soap opera Dark Shadows joins late night creature features and local markets on the airwaves. And Hammer Films' violent revivals of the classic monster lineup gain popularity in theaters. Rock and roll itself was about to go on through its own metamorphosis. November 11th, 1966, Jimi Hendrix plays Big Apple Club in Munich, Germany. He uses an arbiter fuzz face. The crowd likes the sound so much, they pulled him off stage, breaking his guitar neck, which prompted Jimmy to finish it on stage for the first time. The 24th, Jimmy records for the first time with this pedal on the Love or Confusion sessions. November 25th, Time publishes another positive article on LSD almost 2 months after it is ruled illegal in California. The beginning of December, Aspen magazine releases its third issue. Along with the issue is a split record to which the Velvet Underground provide the B-side song entitled Loop. The song features over 7 minutes of droning distorted bass. The original vinyl features a closed groove so the riff is repeated infinitely. December 9th, Cream releases their first album. Also sometime during this year, Ermine Schmidt makes a trip to New York City to spend time with musicians Steve Reich, Lamont Young, and Terry Riley. While there, he is exposed to Andy Warhol and the Velvet Underground. Changed by the trip, he returns home to Cologne, Germany, to later form Can and influence the entire Krautrock scene of the 70s. Schmidt said, quote, "We were never at all influenced by the English. The Velvets, the Stooges, James Brown, Sly Stone, yes. Actually, my revelation was Jimi Hendrix." Terry Riley also goes on to release Reed Streams, a 2-track album of repetitive sounds, and Steve Reich records Come Out, which features audio from the Harlem riots, but repeated through multiple tape decks in various speeds until the audio almost makes rhythms. Kenneth Anger was also beginning to write the film Lucifer Rising while living in San Francisco, inspired by the counterculture movement in the air at the time, and Aleister Crowley's idea of Lucifer being a bringer of light and bestower of knowledge. He begins searching for someone who was, quote, "the ultimate bad little boy who could corrupt you without coercion," and finds Bobby Bassoleil. Charlemagne Palestine is a bongo drummer performing with Anger at this time. Also this year, Mick Jagger appears in The Process of the Final Judgments magazine. The church believed that both Jesus and Satan were to be praised because in end times, Jesus would hand out judgments and Satan would enforce the punishments. Paul McCartney also appeared 2 issues later in the Fear issue due to connections with girlfriend Jane Asher. January 11, 1967, the Jimi Hendrix Experience performs at the Bag of Nails Club. In attendance was Pete Townsend, John Entwistle, Mick Jagger, Brian Jones, Jeff Beck, and Eric Clapton. After the show, Townsend said, quote, "Jimmy changed the whole sound of electric guitar and turned the rock world upside down." Clapton said, quote, "After Pete Townsend and I went to see him play, I thought that was it. The game was up for all of us. We may as well pack it in." The 14th, the Human Be-In was held in Golden Gate Park. This helped to establish San Francisco as the center of the counterculture movement and introduce the word psychedelic to ordinary suburbia. Some of the focuses of the meeting included personal empowerment, higher consciousness through drugs, and radical political beliefs. At this event was Timothy Leary, who delivered his famous turn on, tune in, drop out line. Owsley Stanley gave out LSD to the crowd. Also uncredited were Beausoleil and Anger. Through hanging out in this scene, Anger meets Anton LaVey. The 29th, Hendrix played the Savile Theatre in London and Cream was in the audience. Clapton said, quote, "He played this gig that was blinding. I don't think Jack had really taken him in before." That night, Bruce wrote the bass line of Sunshine of Your Love. At the last minute, after an uneventful writing session, Bruce pulled out the bass line. There was Jack's friend and lyricist, Pete Brown, who looked out the window and saw the sun rising and said, "It's getting near dawn." The same month, rumors emerged that Paul McCartney is killed in a car wreck, leading people to scour the albums for hidden meanings in either the artwork or the back masking the Beatles would continue to use. March 12th, The Velvet Underground and Nico is released, three tracks of which feature Cale's droning viola. Venus in Furs featured Lou Reed's guitar and his self-proclaimed ostrich tuning, which meant that each string was tuned to the same note, in this case, D. In addition, Maureen Tucker said that the frets from this guitar were removed. John Cale recognized the significance of this song because of his drone background with Lamont Young. The ostrich tuning was also used on All Tomorrow's Parties. Heroin was written earlier. Quote, "I was working for a record company as a songwriter where they'd lock me in a room and they'd say, write 10 surfing songs, you know? And I wrote Heroin and I said, hey, I got something for you. They said, never happened, never happened." The last song featuring Cale's trademark sound was Black Angel's Death Song. This one was written by both Reed and Cale and is marked by his viola and his hissing at the end of each verse. The same day, Rosemary's Baby, the story of a woman impregnated with Satan's child, is released. Writer Ira Levin had read up on witchcraft since 1965 in anticipation of writing the book. It goes on to be a bestseller. March 17th, Hendrix's Purple Haze single is released. The track is marked by its psychedelic nature, yet Jimmy's story was more based in the girl-boy frustrations of classic blues. Jimmy said, quote, "The key to the meaning of the song lies in the line, that girl put a spell on me. It's nothing to do with drugs. It's about this guy. This guy turned this cat on and he doesn't know whether it's good or bad. That's all." March 25th, Cream played their first American date at the RKO Manhattan Theater, playing through April 2nd. March 31st, the Jimi Hendrix Experience was set to play an opening slot in Britain. While hanging out at London's Finsbury Park Astoria, he talked with his manager Chaz Chandler and journalist Keith Altman on how to draw attention and press to himself during the show. Smashing his guitar was not even an option, as Pete Townsend had already made it his trademark. So Altham said, quote, "Isn't it a pity you can't set your guitar on fire?" That night, Jimmy did just that after performing Fire. The fire marshal and security men exploded, but Hendrix found himself in the papers. April 3rd, Cream enters Atlantic Studios in New York. They arrive with multiple Marshall amplifiers, each of which 100 watts. Quote, "They recorded at ear-shattering level. Everyone I'd worked with before was using Fender Deluxes or Twins, 6- and 7-piece bands that didn't play as loud as this 3-piece did." May 4th, Jimi Hendrix begins the sessions for Axis Bold as Love. His guitar tech at this time was Lemmy Kilmister. He got the job because he was sleeping on experienced bassist Noel Redding's floor at the time. Quote, "After he played, we would have to repair his fuzz boxes because he'd just stomp all over them, and they'd go into bits all over the stage, and you'd have to go find the bits and put them back together." May 12th, Jimi Hendrix's Are You Experienced was released. The 16th, Jimmy plays the Big Apple Club in Munich, Germany. And the audience was guitarist-violinist Chris Carter. This performance led him to go home, smash his jazz records, and shortly thereafter form Amandul. The same month, Cream records their Disraeli Gears album. The album is produced by Felix Pappalardi, who helped them co-write Strange Brew and World of Pain. The band releases the Tales of Brave Ulysses single at this time. June 1st, the Beatles, the most popular band in the world, also went psychedelic with Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. The cover features many people who influenced the group. Nestled in the top row, two people over, was famed occultist and self-proclaimed Satanist Aleister Crowley. People who normally would have taken the Beatles at everything they said had just now had the most infamous Satanist in English history recommended to them, and with Lennon's Bigger Than Jesus line still fresh in everyone's minds. August 5th, Pink Floyd releases Piper at the Gates of Dawn. The title is taken from a chapter of The Wind in the Willows, where the characters meet the ancient god Pan and are seemingly initiated into his cult. The image of Pan was a big influence on Satan's appearance as we know him. Also during the Summer of Love, Process members were stationed at 407 Cole Street in San Francisco, while lifetime criminal Charles Manson lived at 636 Cole Street. They also try to form an alliance with Anton LaVey, which fails. LaVey, however, befriends Sammy Davis Jr. and Jane Mansfield and uses these connections to get into Hollywood. September 1967, the Velvet Underground record White Light, White Heat. The album is recorded in just 2 days. John Cale said it was, quote, "a very rabid record. The first one had some gentility, some beauty. The second one was consciously anti-beauty." Sterling Morrison said, quote, "we were all pulling in the same direction. We may have been dragging each other off a cliff, but we were all definitely going in the same direction. In the White Light, White Heat era, our lives were chaos. That's what reflected in the record." During the recording, producer Tony Wilson left the recording of Sister Ray saying, quote, "I don't have to listen to this. I'll put it in record, and then I'm leaving. When you're done, come get me." The Ray in the title was a reference to Ray Davies of the Kinks. Around this time, many kids had returned back home to continue with college, so on October 6th, the Death of the Hippie was held. Organizer Mary Casper said, quote, "we wanted to signal that this was the end of it, to stay where you are, bring the revolution to where you live, and don't come here because it's over and done with." Late October, a falling out occurred between Anger and Bosalo. Bobby steals Anger's car, camera equipment, and some of the footage of Lucifer Rising. He then moved down to Topanga Canyon, where he eventually meets Charles Manson. November, Cream releases Disraeli Gears. This album was the band's American breakthrough. The cover artwork is done by Martin Sharp, who lived in the same building as Clapton. He also co-wrote Tales of Brave Ulysses. The photograph for the cover was taken by Bob Whitaker, who did the Beatles' Butcher cover. December 8th, The Stones released their Satanic Majesty's Request. One proposed cover was a picture of Jagger naked on a cross and was refused by the record label. The album would come under fire due to its title, and its psychedelic sound was soon dumped afterwards. In late 1967 into 68, Chicago band Coven was opening shows for the likes of the Yardbirds and Alice Cooper. At the beginning and end of each concert, singer Jinx Dawson would flash the sign of the horns, thus introducing the sign of the devil to the hard rock and metal scene. January 16th, Blue Cheer released their Vincibus Eruptum album. On the cover is Summertime Blues. Bass player, vocalist Dickie Peterson said, quote, "we kept changing it around and adding slash taking bits away. It also has to do with large doses of LSD. January 22nd, Iron Butterfly release Heavy. The last track on the album is Iron Butterfly Theme, and is a heavy, slowed-down riffing piece. The 30th, The Velvet Underground releases White Light, White Heat. Upon release, the album only charts at 199 of 200, then disappears. February 2nd, Blue Cheer released the Summertime Blues single. It reaches number 14 on the Billboard chart. At this time, filmmaker Kenneth Anger moves to Britain and meets the Rolling Stones. Anger at that time was still working on Lucifer Rising, and even proposed to Jagger about playing the role of Satan, which he considered. Mick ended up composing a soundtrack for the movie that was used on another of Anger's films. March 27th through the 28th, Terry Riley records In C. May through June, the Rolling Stones record Sympathy for the Devil. Keith Richards said, quote, "Before we were just innocent kids out for a good time. They're saying, they're evil, they're evil. Oh, I'm evil, really? So that makes you start thinking about evil. What is evil? Half of it, I don't know how much people think of Mick as the devil or as just a good rock performer or what. There are black magicians who think we are acting as unknown agents of Lucifer, and others who think we are Lucifer. Everybody's Lucifer." June 12th, the Rosemary's Baby movie is released. Actress Mia Farrow, who at the time was married to Frank Sinatra, who was friends with the Beatles, helped to make the darkness more fashionable. She, raised as a Catholic, later said, quote, "My religion, as it had been presented to me and as I had interpreted it, was no longer helpful, satisfying, or even acceptable to me." Anton LaVey said the movie was, quote, "the best paid commercial for Satanism since the Inquisition." At this time, The Crazy World of Arthur Brown released their single, Fire, in the UK. The single was produced by Pete Townsend. The song starts off with Arthur proclaiming, "I am the God of Hellfire," and the cover depicts his outfit he wore for live gigs. The same month, Deep Purple is picked up for Cream's Goodbye Tour. Also, Can forms in Germany. An early practice of theirs is recorded. Quote, "Can never wrote anything, not on paper. We thought, today we don't have to write on paper. Like Beethoven or Mozart, we write on tape." Irmine Schmidt said, quote, "the thing of repeating a sentence, a banal sentence, but repeated about 70, 80 times, is pop art, like having 150 cartons of Brillo by Andy Warhol. In a way, it's the same idea. The repetition of this banality, it becomes something else. Can or not a pop group, it's pop art, it's art music. It's part of a tradition, but maybe the difference is, it's part of a new tradition." July 7th, the Yardbirds performed their last live gig. Jimmy Page soon contacted Terry Reid about being the lead singer in his new band. At this point, Reid had commitments to join Cream on their tour, so he suggests Robert Plant. In August 1968, Iron Butterfly released their Inna Gotta Da Vida single. The same month, the Yardbirds break up and Jimmy Page begins picking new members for his band, the New Yardbirds. He picks up Robert Plant, John Paul Jones, and John Bonham. Cream also releases their Wheels of Fire album, and Jeff Beck releases his album Truth with Beck's Bolero on it. September, the New Yardbirds tour to Scandinavia, playing older Birds material along with newer material. At that same time, John Osborne, Tony Iommi, Geezer Butler, and Bill Ward began jamming as a way to escape the monotony of factory life. Influenced by British hard rock of the time, they formed Polka Tolk, which later became Earth. They also dropped this name after one day of practicing next to a movie theater. Quote, "there was something like The Devil Rides Out showing there, and Tony said it was strange the way people pay money to see horror films and get scared. So we said, why don't we start to write scary music?" Many names were considered when Geezer finally said, quote, "call it Black Sabbath." September 2nd, Clifford Cooper was running a failing music shop / recording studio in London called Orange. They specialized in older gear, and when they couldn't find enough stock, the decision was made to make amplifiers. 50 prototypes of the OR-100 were made in the back of a tobacco shop. word spread and demand for the amp was high almost overnight. September 27th, the Velvet Underground played their last gig with John Cale and the band. Tensions had been rising between Cale and Reed for some time, as Cale wanted the band to be more avant-garde and Reed wanted the band more commercial. Things came to a head when Reed called Morrison and Tucker together and said either Cale was out of the band or the band would stop. They reluctantly agreed. Mo Tucker said, quote, "When John left, it was really sad. I felt really bad. And of course, this was going to really influence the music, because John's a lunatic. I think we became a little more normal, which was fine. It was good music, good songs. It was never the same, though. It was good stuff, a lot of good songs. But just, the lunacy factor was gone." At this time, the new Yardbirds changed their name to Led Zeppelin and start recording their first album in October. The A in the name was later dropped because Jimmy thought American audiences wouldn't catch on and end up calling the band Led Zeppelin. Page uses a Tone Bender Professional Mark II and states that, quote, "He used it for 75% of his sound. His guitar is a 1958 Telecaster, the one given to him by Jeff Beck upon his joining the Yardbirds." The album was basically their live set at the time, minus a couple songs, and it was recorded with a minimum of overdubs to best recreate that so the band could sell the album while on tour. Robert said, quote, "That first album was the first time that headphones meant anything to me. What I heard coming back to me over the cans while I was singing was better than any chick in all the land. It had so much weight, so much power. It was devastating." December 11th, 1968, the Rolling Stones recorded their Rock and Roll Circus film. During Sympathy for the Devil, Mick Jagger removes his shirt, revealing a tattoo of the devil on his arm and chest. This performance is also the only instance where young guitarist Tony Iommi plays with Jethro Tull. January 12th, Led Zeppelin releases their first album. The front cover is a picture of the Hindenburg crash, a reference to the lead balloon comet. And the back cover is a photo of the band done by Yardbirds guitarist turned bassist Chris Deha, who took up photography after the band ended. Also at this time, Leslie West forms a band and begins playing shows. Former Cream collaborator Felix Pappalardi offers to produce them. Spring 1969, Deep Purple's song Hush was a top 5 hit. The band at this time decides to make a switch from psychedelic rock to a harder sound. On June 4th, guitarist Richie Blackmore, organist John Lord, and drummer Ian Pace saw band Episode 6 play. The lead singer was Ian Gillan. He was a part of the band 12 days later. June 29th, the Jimi Hendrix Experience played its final gig. Tensions between Hendrix and Redding had been rising steadily, and things were finalized when a journalist asked Redding why he was there, as Hendrix had told him 2 weeks earlier he was being replaced. The night of July 2nd, Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones is discovered motionless in his pool. He dies shortly afterward, and word circulates for years that foul play was in effect. July, Leslie West releases Mountain. Soon after, him and bassist vocalist Pappalardi formed the band named after that same album. In the early morning hours of August 9th, Manson family members commit the Tate murders. Pig was written on the front door in reference to the Beatles song. Later that day, they commit the LaBianca murders, and this time write Rise and Helter Skelter, again referencing the Beatles' White Album. August 16th, Mountain played Woodstock. August 18th, Jimi Hendrix plays Woodstock. By this point, most of the people had left, and he only plays to about 200,000 people. Also asked to play were Led Zeppelin and Iron Butterfly, who turned the festival down. August 30th, 1969, Black Sabbath plays their first gig. Also this summer, while on tour, Led Zeppelin was hanging with members of the girl band The GTOs, who were associated with Zappa at the time. Miss Pamela went on to state Jimmy's obsession with Aleister Crowley. Quote, "He was really into that stuff. I believe that Jimmy was very into black magic and probably did a lot of our rituals, candles, bat's blood, the whole thing. I believe he did that stuff." October 12th, someone called the WKNR DJ Russ Gibb about the Paul is Dead rumor. This leads to album sales for the band and much more scrutiny over the artwork of covers. This leads to people playing said albums backwards for hidden messages. October 16th, Black Sabbath records their first album in one day. Iommi said, quote, "We just went in and did it in a day. We played our live set and that was it. We thought, we have 2 days to do it, and one of the days is mixing. So we played live. Ozzy was singing at the same time. We just put him in a separate booth and off we went. We never had a second run of most of the stuff." At the start of recording, Iommi was using his white Fender Stratocaster, but when a pickup failed, he switched to his Gibson SG he kept as a backup. October 22nd, Led Zeppelin 2 is released. At the time, Jimmy had switched his Telecaster to his more trademarked Les Paul. It was engineered by Eddie Kramer and had been recorded over a span of time in different studios ranging from London, New York, and LA. The album entered the charts at 199, then by next week was at 25, then made its way to 2, and by December had even misplaced the Beatles' Abbey Road at number 1. November, Black Sabbath signed to Philips Records. On the 16th, they perform at Dumfries in Scotland. And the audience that night were members of Iron Claw, who decide to base their sound on the band. December 6th, the Rolling Stones hold a free concert at Altamont Speedway. The Hells Angels were used as security, and their pay was $500 worth of beer. Heavily liquored up by the time the Stones took the stage, violence had already been steadily going off. During the third song, Sympathy for the Devil, the band stopped playing to urge everyone to calm down. 4 songs later, during the intro of Under My Thumb, 18-year-old Meredith Hunter tried to get on stage, to which security knocked him back. A minute later, he tried again and began to draw a revolver. Rock Scully, who was stationed on a truck near the stage, said, quote, "I saw what he was looking at, that he was crazy, he was on drugs, and that he had murderous intent. There was no doubt in my mind that he intended to do terrible harm to Mick or somebody in the Rolling Stones." Alan Pissarro of the Hells Angels draws his knife and stabs him twice, killing him. December 25th, Black Sabbath is called in by manager Jim Simpson to view their first album. Ozzy, thinking the cover would be a shot of the band, was surprised to see the artwork. "I looked at the sleeve and love it. With the chick on the front and all that fucking black in the middle." Jim then put the album on. Upon hearing the intro before the title track, Ozzy said, "Whoa, Pink Floyd after all." The album was chosen to be simply named Black Sabbath after both Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple releasing self-named albums earlier that year. The same year, Coven's album, Witchcraft Destroys Minds and Reaps Souls, is released by Mercury Records. Coincidentally enough, the first track on the album was called Black Sabbath, and their bassist was named Oz Osborne. Also the same year, Amon Dole released their first album, Psychedelic Underground, showing off an obviously drony Velvet Underground influence. And Lamont Young releases The Black Record, featuring one song recorded that year and an experiment with gongs from 1964. January 1970, Black Sabbath releases their Evil Woman single. That same month, Deep Purple releases the Speed King Into the Fire single. Friday, February the 13th, 1970, Black Sabbath releases Black Sabbath in England. The gatefold of the record released in England had an inverted cross with a poem written inside of it. This was originally picked by designer Keith McMillan. Iommi said, quote, "Suddenly we had all these crazy people turning up at shows." The album hit number 8 on the charts upon release. Perhaps the greatest mood setter of the album was the first track. Black Sabbath was written after Geezer Butler listened to Gustav Holst's Mars and played the bass line one day at a practice. Quote, "I was playing it on me bass one day, and Tony changed it a bit, and it went from there." Tony's line also mirrors the Devil's Triad from the Middle Ages, that was actually outlawed due to thinking it would actually summon the devil. The story of the song came from a personal experience of geezers with the occult. Quote, I was reading every book that came out about it. There were a lot of underground magazines around then. Plus, I used to go down to London for the weekend to a place called Middle Earth. There used to be, like, these occult groups of people, and they used to give out all this literature, and they had their own magazines. There was one called Madness and Magic, which was like a monthly magazine that you collected that was all about black magic, and I used to read all that stuff. I was getting into, not practicing, but reading a lot of spiritualism and black magic and white magic and all that kind of stuff, which a lot of people were doing at that time. It was like the post-hippie generation kind of thing. Peace and love is going out the window, and spiritualism and meditation was in, so I was into that. And somebody gave Ozzy this old 16th century book of black magic, and it was all written in, I think, Latin. And he brought it right over to my flat because he knew I was interested in books and magic and that kind of thing. I just got this really weird vibe off it. And I put it in this cupboard in the apartment I was living in, and that night I just woke up suddenly, and I just saw this black shape at the bottom of my bed, and it just vanished into thin air as I was staring at it. And I just had this thought, it's got to do something with that book Ozzy gave me. I leapt out of bed, rushed to the cupboard to throw this book out, and the book was gone. Geezer couldn't sleep for the rest of the night, and completely redecorated his apartment the next day and began wearing a cross. A couple of days later, the song began taking shape, becoming a warning against Satanism. Geezer said, quote, all the love and peace thing had come and gone. The Vietnam War thing was happening, and a lot of kids were getting into all kinds of mysticism and occultism. The Wizard was an Earth leftover based on J.R.R. Tolkien's Gandalf character. Behind the Wall of Sleep is about the H.P. Lovecraft story of an inmate who would transcend sleep to soar through abysses of emptiness, burning every obstacle that stood in his way. NIB was quite literally named Nib after Bill Ward's beard, which ended in a point. Geezer said, quote, it looked like a pen nib, so we called it Nib. It's our kind of knock against love songs. We hated listening to love songs, so I thought, I'll write a satanic love song. The line, I'll give you the moon and the stars, that was like the ultimate chat-up line, because the devil could do that kind of thing. Evil Woman was a Crow cover, pushed on the band by management, and Warning was an Ansley Dunbar track the band covered from their Earth days. The album was mixed in the span of one day. The same month, Atomic Rooster released their first self-titled album. In the band are ex-Crazy World of Arthur Brown members. March 1970, Esquire magazine prints their Evil Lurks in California issue. The article linked the counterculture's interest in the occult to the Charles Manson murders. They also name-dropped Coven's album. This unwanted publicity forced Mercury to pull the album from shelves. The same month, band Black Widow released their album Sacrifice. The album's lyrical themes center on Satanism and the occult, and most of Middle America begins to confuse them and Black Sabbath as the same band, thus bolstering Sabbath's reputation. Frontman Clive Jones said, quote, after Sacrifice, we had to change direction, and I didn't want to do that, but we'd had lots of bad luck. We were banned by the BBC, and they wouldn't play the records. We were gonna tour America, but Charles Manson did what they called his black magic murders, and suddenly we weren't allowed in. Our management looked after Black Sabbath at the time too, and sent them in our place. Also this month, Led Zeppelin began their American tour. The feeling in the air at that time was majorly divided. The younger kids opposed Vietnam, and protests were starting to turn violent when police stepped in. Cops began showing up in riot gear to gigs. April 26th, Black Sabbath plays the John Peel Show due to being managed by Peel acquaintance Jim Simpson. Ozzy said, quote, if it wasn't for John Peel, Black Sabbath would never have been played on the radio. He was a good guy. June 1st, Black Sabbath was released in America and met with much of the same optimism by fans. June 3rd, Deep Purple's In Rock was released. On the 5th, Black Sabbath was set to start touring America, but dates were dropped when the Manson trial was starting on the same day, and Warner Brothers viewed this to be a backlash in the making. This proved truer when over a month later, when Manson arrived, he showed up with an X carved in his head, and headlines and speculation on its occult meanings flowed. When it came out that the Beatles song Helter Skelter might have had a hand in it, rock and roll and the occult, or evil, were linked yet again in America's eyes. Even though the tour was canceled, Warner Brothers had already had plans underway for a Black Sabbath parade held on Folsom Street in San Francisco. It had been organized by Anton LaVey, who appeared with drag queens and gays in dresses and a banner that read, "Warner Brothers Records welcomes Black Sabbath, the dawn of the Aquarius." Ozzy said, quote, "I remember going, that can't be for us, man. But it was the Black Sabbath parade, and it was held on this certain fucking astrological day or something. I mean, I got scared. I wouldn't go out of my room for fucking weeks." June 13th, Uriah Heep releases their first album. Very heavy, very humble. The album is panned immediately. Rolling Stone's Melissa Mills said, quote, "If this group makes it, I'll have to commit suicide. From the first note, you know you don't want to hear anymore." The UK cover featured lead singer David Byron underneath cobwebs. June 16th through the 21st, Black Sabbath returns to studios to record their new album War Pigs, which Warner made them change to Paranoid. War Pigs had been around since their first album, but was never included as they didn't have the time to record it. The song's idea was taken from when Sabbath used to play American military bases in Germany. Geezer said, quote, "They were like halfway houses. They used to come from Vietnam and have a couple of weeks at these bases in Germany before they went back to America, you know, just to get back to reality kind of thing. And I used to talk to them and they tell me these horrendous stories about Vietnam and about all the heroin and how people used to be on drugs just to get away from it all over there because of how horrible it was." Paranoid was written last minute. Quote, "We didn't have enough songs for the album, and Tony just played the guitar lick, and that was it. It took 20-25 minutes from top to bottom." Geezer, for one, was totally against it. "I said to Tony, it's too much like Zeppelin. We can't do that. I thought it was a communication breakdown. I thought it was so much like that we couldn't possibly get away with it." Planet Caravan was a song the rest of the band wasn't behind initially. Tony said, quote, "The others were like, well, where is that gonna go? I tried to explain, quote, well, it's good to do that because then it makes the heavier album tracks sound heavier." Iron Man came from Geezer's sci-fi obsession and was a warning of letting technology get out of human control. Electric Funeral tells how nuclear war was more or less no longer a threat but a promise in the future. Hand of Doom was a warning tale of the dangers of heroin addiction. And Fairies Wear Boots came from a fight between the band and a group of skinheads. July 1st, Cactus released their first album. The band is formed by Vanilla Fudge bassist and drummer Tim Boger and Carmine Appice, with the plans of teaming up with Jeff Beck. Beck ends up in an automobile accident and is out of the music scene for a year. August 7th, the Paranoid single was released. September 17th, in Rolling Stone magazine, Lester Bangs reviews Black Sabbath's first album. In short, he calls them, quote, "just like Cream, but worse." This was the first and only time the magazine wrote about Sabbath unless blasting their name for years. September 18th, Paranoid is released in Europe. The same day, Jimi Hendrix was pronounced dead. Word also arises that Hendrix may have actually been killed. October 5th, Led Zeppelin 3 is released. The original run-out grooves are etched with "Do What Thou Wilt, and So Mote Be It," referencing Aleister Crowley. At this time, Jimmy owned the Equinox booksellers and publishers in London. Quote, "There was not one bookshop in London with a good collection of occult books, and I was so pissed off not being able to get the books I wanted." That same month, UFO's first self-titled album is released. November 10th, Black Sabbath opened for the Faces at the Fillmore. Tony said, quote, "When we went on, the crowd went absolutely mental. Then Rod Stewart came on, and they began throwing things at him. It was just incredible. From then on, we became like the underground band in America. Sir Lord Baltimore's Kingdom Come album is released in December 1970, and mixing is done by Eddie Kramer, who had worked with Jimi Hendrix. Also at this time, Jimmy Page purchases Aleister Crowley's Boleskin House. Page said, quote, "I was living it. That's all there is to it. It was my life, that fusion of music and magic." The same year, Finnish band The Sperm released their Shh album. Some early elements of drone are apparent, and German band Popovul released their first album, Affenstund, also of a droney nature. That same month, Atomic Rooster releases Death Walks Behind You, their second album. Also this year, Lucifer's Friend released their first self-titled album. January 1971, Paranoid is released in the US. The same month, German band Cluster record their first self-titled record. The 44-minute album features three tracks of droning electronics. February 19th through the 20th, Sir Lord Baltimore plays opening for Black Sabbath on the Paranoid Tour. On this tour, their stardom started to become apparent. Quote, "We attracted unbelievable amounts of nutters from Satanists to acid casualties. You name it, we had them," Tony said. Ozzy said, quote, "I got scared. You get people walk up and go, man, we know that you know that we know that you know. And we'd go, yeah, well, keep on knowing, man." There was every Satanist you could ever imagine and every Jesus freak. May 1971, Mike Saunders writes a review of Kingdom Come for Cream. He writes, quote, "Sir Lord Baltimore seemed to have down pat most all the best heavy metal tricks in the book." That same month, Flower Traveling Band releases their 45, Satori. June, the self-titled debut album by Budgie is released. July 21st, Black Sabbath releases Master of Reality. Bill Ward said, quote, "During Master of Reality, we started getting more experimental and began taking too much time to record." Iommi said, quote, "We tried recording Into the Void in a couple different studios because Bill just couldn't get it right." During recording an acoustic part, Ozzy brought Tony a huge joint, which when hit caused Tony to cough uncontrollably. This was later sampled by Roger Bain and put at the beginning of the album. Sweet Leaf was written in the studio, and while trying to think of a name, Geezer pulled out his Sweet Afton cigarettes. Quote, "I took out this cigarette packet, and as you opened it, it's got on the lid, the sweetest leaf you can buy. I was like, ah, Sweet Leaf." After Forever was a response to Sabbath being thought of as a purely satanic band, and Geezer being a devout Catholic. Embryo and Orchid were instrumentals. Children of the Grave was an anti-war song like War Pigs and Electric Funeral. Lord of This World was described as their, quote, "one and only Satan song." Into the Void was half fantasy, half environmental protest. Ozzy said, quote, "When Geezer gave me the lyrics, I said, are you trying to kill me?" Iommi said, quote, "It has this slow bit, but then the riff where Osborne comes in is very fast. Seeing him try was hilarious." September 10th, Sabbath opened for Zeppelin at the Onondaga War Memorial Auditorium in Syracuse, New York, and the next night in Rochester. As a result, Master of Reality became their biggest chart topper. At one point, all three Sabbath albums were charting at the same time. On the 20th, while playing Memphis, someone drew a cross and fresh blood across their dressing room door and nailed it shut. October 1971, the Iron Man Electric Funeral single was released. The same month, the band obliged Rolling Stone doing an interview so that they could make fun of them. Geezer claimed to be able to see the devil, and Ozzy claimed to be the first member in the group who would die. After a show in LA on the 5th, producer Kim Fowley suggests that Ozzy go to Mexico, buy a corpse, and stab it on stage. Also at this time, Kenneth Anger is outbid at a Sotheby's auction for Aleister Crowley merchandise by Jimmy Page. He then meets Jimmy, and through their mutual interest, Anger asks him to write the soundtrack to Lucifer Rising. It is recorded at the Boleskine House. The piece lasts almost 24 minutes and is a slow, droning song featuring screeching strings. His original scoring is rejected. November 8th, Led Zeppelin releases their fourth album. With no band name or musicians credited on the sleeve, the band took up four symbols to represent them. Jimmy Page's is a magic sigil he makes up himself. The first three letters are ZOS, taken from musical philosophies of Crawley's associate, Austin Osmond Spare, who went by the name Zos Vel Thantanos. The cover features a man carrying sticks on his back as a reference to the Ten of Wands tarot card, which represented burden, responsibility, hard work, stress, and achievement. On the inside of the LP is a reference to the tarot card, the Hermit, which holds multiple meanings. Mountains are known to symbolize growth and achieving your goals. The mountain also signifies that his secrets are only meant for those who want to actively seek them. The star is a six-pointed one indicating wisdom, and the staff is a patriarch's staff, a symbol of power, and the staff is in his left hand, the hand associated with the subconscious. December 4th, Deep Purple were in Montreal, Switzerland. One night, before starting work on their next album, they went to see Frank Zappa perform at the casino. During the synth solo on King Kong, someone in the audience shot off a flare gun, setting the casino on fire. The band watched the end of the fire from their hotel as the smoke wafted off into Lake Geneva. A few days later, bassist Roger Glover came up with the title, Smoke on the Water. The 25th, the classic lineup of Pentagram begins practice. The same year, Rhys Chatham begins to work with Lamont Young. Quote, I had worked my way through my student years by tuning pianos and harpsichords. I loved Lamont's piece, but made a comment that, as a professional piano tuner, I thought his piano was a bit out of tune and that maybe I should tune it for him. Lamont thought this was very funny. From there, he begins to sing in the Theater of Eternal Music. Pupple Vol released their second album, In Den Garten Pharos. Side 1 of the title track features Moog synth, Fender piano, African percussion, and the root of all drone, Sounds of Nature. The second track clocks in at about 20 minutes and is based around one chord played on a medieval cathedral organ. Also at this time, the band Leafhound releases their Growers of Mushroom album. They break up shortly after its recording. In addition, the novel The Exorcist is released. During 1972, Pentagram, under original name Macabre, write the song Forever My Queen. February, while on tour, Sabbath played 31 shows in 33 days. Ozzy said, in America, we were just out of our minds. We wouldn't sleep for fucking days. May and Bill were the worst. We were like the drug commandos. Never go through a door where a plate glass window will do. Also at this time, Lemmy Kilmister joins Hawkwind. June, Cream magazine puts Sabbath on their cover. Ozzy told the journalist, quote, one concert in America, after the show, on the floor there was 1,000 fucking syringes. I was amazed. I felt sick. I really felt ill to think I had just performed to people that were one step nearer to the hole. He goes on, quote, we got all sorts of letters, all sorts of things in blood, you name it, we had it. The 19th, Time publishes their cover with a hooded figure and the Occult Revival headline. July, Captain Beyond released their self-titled album. The band features ex-Deep Purple and Iron Butterfly members. August, Tangerine Dream released Zeet. And on the first track is Florian Frick of Pupple Vuh. September 15th, Black Sabbath played the Hollywood Bowl in California. In the time leading up to the concert, Ozzy reports, quote, Tony had been doing coke literally for days. We all had, but Tony had gone over the edge. I mean, that stuff just twists your whole idea of reality. You start seeing things that aren't there, and Tony was gone. Near the end of the gig, he walked off stage and collapsed. Geezer Butler said, quote, Tony collapsed. It was a really touch and go at one point, whether he'd survive or not, because he was totally depleted. So we had to cancel the rest of the tour, and we actually took time off for the first time since the band started. We got away from each other and had a social life. Then we came back together to start on the next album and couldn't come up with anything. September 25th, Black Sabbath released Volume 4. October, Tony Conrad had been reached by Hugh Nettlebeck, who was German band Faust's producer, to work with the band. He at the time still working with Lamont Young with the Theater of Eternal Music, which at this time was working under the title The Dream Syndicate, took up the offer, and the album was called Outside the Dream Syndicate, referencing it was a side project. November 24th, Hawkwind releases Do Re Mi Fa Sol La Ti Do. The lineup of the band changed as Dave Brock took up lead guitar and Lemmy was on bass. Quote, I learned to play bass on stage with Hawkwind. I just don't play like a bass player. December 22nd, Hawkwind record at Liverpool Stadium. This show, along with their performance at Brixton Sundown on the 30th, ended up becoming their live album, Space Ritual. The same year, German band Night Sun releases their only album, Morning. At the end of this year, Dust drummer Mark Bell begins playing with other bands to be later associated with the punk scene. Early 1973, band Necromandus record their first album, Orexis of Death. Tony Iommi plays on the title track. This album went unreleased after their lead guitarist quits the band. May 11th, Hawkwind releases Space Ritual. August, Australian band Buffalo released their second album, Volcanic Rock. September, Black Sabbath starts recording Sabbath Bloody Sabbath. The band decided to recreate the same atmosphere of the last album and decided to return to Record Plant Studios and began writing the new album as far back as that summer. But touring, fatigue, and drugs had taken their toll on the band, particularly Tony Iommi. Quote, everybody was sitting there waiting for me to come up with something. I just couldn't think of anything. And if I didn't come up with anything, nobody would do anything. I panicked because I didn't have a single idea about what to write. It might have been the drugs, it could have been the pressure, but either way I felt it was my fault. Butler said, quote, we thought that we were finished as a band. Once Tony came out with the initial riff for Sabbath Bloody Sabbath, we went, we're back. October, Black Sabbath releases the Sabbath Bloody Sabbath single. December 1st, Black Sabbath releases Sabbath Bloody Sabbath. Ozzy later said, Sabbath Bloody Sabbath was really the album after which I could have said goodbye, because after that, I really started unraveling. Then we ended up falling out of favor with each other. For the first time in their career, Rolling Stone actually reviewed the album favorably, saying it was, quote, an extraordinarily gripping affair. December 26th, one day after Christmas Day, The Exorcist is released in theaters. It goes on to make $66 million and be one of the top-grossing R-rated films of all time. The same year, Pentagram releases The Hurricane Earth Flight 45. 1974, Lamont Young with the Theater of Eternal Music releases Dreamhouse 7817. Side B is one continuous signal of a synthwave. This was an experiment that Young had performed at his house from September 1966 to January 1970, where the synthwave was played continuously, only being turned off when other music was playing or to study the effects that the sudden silence had on him. Young and collaborator Marian Zazila carried on normal life within this setting and studied the effects this had on them and their visitors. Pentagram also releases the Under My Thumb When the Screams Come 45. July 28, 1975, Black Sabbath releases Sabotage. The title is chosen because of legal troubles at the time with former management. Geezer said, around the time of Sabbath Bloody Sabbath, we found out we were being ripped off by our management and our record company. Writs were sent to them while they were mixing the album, and the last song in the album addresses this. Tony spent a lot of time with producer Mike Butcher working on his guitar sound, and Bill Ward was experimenting with his drum sound as well. The album was taking so long that Ozzy was becoming frustrated, and at one point, the London Philharmonic Choir was used on Superstar, which prompted him to leave the studio thinking he was in the wrong place. The same month, Lou Reed releases Metal Machine Music. The album consists of over an hour of feedback, played back at various speeds, and is influenced by the works of Lamont Young and the Theater of Eternal Music. Reed even talked of trying to get classical label Red Seal to release it. December 16th, Pentagram lead singer Bobby Liebling was arrested. The decision was made by the remaining members that the group would disband, as he held the rights to the name Pentagram, and touring without him would be impossible. February 1976, We Sold Our Soul for Rock and Roll. The album was compiled by their new management company without knowledge of the band. The first time they heard of it was when Iommi was presented with a copy by a fan wishing him to sign it. The same year, Rise Chatham sees the Ramones at CBGB's. When I first heard the Ramones play, it was a revelation to me. I had never seen a rock band play live before. I thought, hey, these guys are playing only three chords. That might have been one or two more chords than I was using in my music at the time, but I could see the similarities and thought that maybe I had more in common with this music than I thought. The same year, Glenn Branca moves to New York. Also the same year, Scott Weinrich forms Warhorse in Baltimore, Maryland. They later become known as The Obsessed. 1977, Rise Chatham starts performing Guitar Trio. He described it as, quote, compositions which tell a story to the listener, but somehow it is the listener's story. Audiences received it somewhat positively. Quote, it was a merge of minimalist tendencies and what was happening at CBGB's. The rock crowd would hear it as a new variation on a wall of sound, whereas my friends would see it as an exciting new strain of minimalism. Glenn Branca is also there performing with Rise. 1978, Steve Reich releases Music for 18 Musicians. The piece is inspired by a dream where Reich and his ensemble are drumming on a beach as the waves hit the shore and fade. The music dwells on a theme for a while, then adds yet another, which continues to drive the album, making the listener more absorbed into the song. Halloween 1978, Liebling reforms Pentagram with new members. April 27, 1979, Black Sabbath fires Ozzy. Bill Ward, a close friend to Ozzy, was chosen to break the news. Iommi said, quote, we were doing a lot of drugs, a lot of coke, a lot of everything, and Ozzy was getting drunk so much at the time. We were supposed to be rehearsing and nothing was happening. June 1979, Pentagram released the Living in a Ram's Head and When the Screams Come 45. September, Geezer leaves Black Sabbath. At this time, Witchfinder General formed. November 5th, while on the Jim Baker Show, presidential candidate Ronald Reagan states, quote, we may be the generation that sees Armageddon. He would go on to cite the end of the world numerous times throughout his presidency. December 1980, Led Zeppelin breaks up due to the death of John Bonham and rumors in tabloids about a Zeppelin curse due to Jimmy's occultist leanings. The same year, Michelle Remembers is published. This is the first book to report of exposing the young to satanic rituals and repressed memories, setting a precursor for the satanic panic of the 80s.